Welcome to episode 5 of Terrain Rendering. In this video, we're going to take a look at lighting and, same as before, we will have two different methods for doing that. The first one is the most obvious and straightforward. The second method is very intriguing, but its practicality can be debated. I hope you will stay until the end of this video because I think you will find it very interesting. Okay, so the simplest way to light a terrain is probably using diffuse lighting. If you have a single light source, such as the sun, which is very far from the surface of the terrain, then the light rays are parallel to each other. In other words, this is a directional light. Now, I did cover diffuse lighting in my OpenGL for Beginners series, so if you need more details, you can find the link in the video description. Right now, I'll just refresh your memory that diffuse lighting is based on calculating the cosine between the reversed light direction and the surface normal. The result is used to attenuate the strength of the light source. If we make sure that the two vectors are unit length, we can simply replace the cosine with the dot product. When the two vectors are aligned, the result of the dot product is 1 and we get maximum lighting. As the angle between them increases, the result of the dot product decreases until we reach 0 when the two vectors are perpendicular to each other. If the angle is more than 90 degrees, the dot product is negative, and in this case we say that light hits the surface from behind, so there is no light. Okay, as I said, all this is covered in my other video, but the only piece that we are still missing is the calculation of the normal vector. The thing is that I've been using SIMP to load all the meshes, and this library will calculate the normals for you if it's not already provided by the modeling software. So this is a good opportunity to actually see how to calculate the normal vectors in the case of a procedurally generated terrain. In general, the normal vector of a plane is calculated using a cross product between any two vectors on that plane. In our case, we simply use two edges of a triangle. Now, there are two types of normals in 3D graphics: a triangle or face normal and a vertex normal. A face normal is constant across the entire face of a triangle, whereas a vertex normal is the average of all the triangle normals that share that vertex. If we use a triangle normal for lighting, we get abrupt changes of the light when switching from one triangle to the next. This is simply because the same normal is used for every pixel in that triangle, while the pixels of its neighbor use an entirely different normal vector. In the case of vertex normals, the interpolation between the vertices causes the normal vector to gradually change across the face of the triangle, which creates a much smoother lighting effect. Vertex normals are considered the default, but you can still use triangle normals if this is the effect that you are looking for. In this video, we will implement vertex normals. Okay, so we need to do a cross product of two edges of each triangle. The way that the cross product operation works is that we get two opposing vectors, depending on the order of the input vectors. In general, we follow the right-hand rule here, so if you place your right hand on the surface with your fingers pointing along the first vector and you curl them towards the second vector, the normal vector follows your thumb. This is considered the front face of the surface, and this is what we need. In this series, I've actually configured the winding order of the front-facing triangles to be clockwise, and this follows the left-hand rule. The two triangles of each quad are constructed by taking the bottom left, top left, and top right indices in that order for the first triangle, and bottom left, top right, and bottom right indices for the second triangle. This means that we can calculate the cross product by simply following this order. The first vector goes from the first vertex to the second vertex, and the second vector goes from the first to the third vertex. So we go from the first to the second vector in a clockwise direction. Okay, let's see some implementation details. First of all, we need to add a new attribute to the vertex structure. The normal vector is, of course, a 3D vector, and notice that it is initialized to 0. This is important for later. Next, we have a function called calcNormals, which takes two STD vectors, the vertices and the indices. Note that this function must be called after the vertices and indices have already been initialized, because we need the positions in the vertices and we need the indices in order to access the vertices in the correct order. CalcNormals traverses the index vector in groups of three. In other words, one triangle at a time. We extract the triangle indices, calculate the two edges of the triangle, and perform the cross product according to the order that we discussed. The resulting vector is normalized. Okay, now for the most important piece. The vertex normal is the average of all the face normals that share this vertex. What we do here is to accumulate the same normal into the vertices of the current triangle. Each vertex can potentially contain the sum of between two vectors in the case of the four corners, and up to six inside the body of the grid. After we complete this process, we go over all the vertices this time, not the indices, and normalize the normal vectors. In addition, we need to tell the vertex shader about this new attribute. So now we have a position, a texture coordinate, and the normal vector. We enable the new vertex attribute and specify the layout. Nothing special here. In the vertex shader, we have a corresponding new input attribute as well as an output attribute. The input is copied into the output. Most of the fun takes place in the fragment shader. Here we have a new uniform variable for the reversed light direction. This vector basically goes from the Earth back towards the distant light source. Since the input normal is changed during the interpolation in the rasterizer, we have to normalize it again before usage. We do a dot product between the normal and the reversed light direction. I also made sure that the result doesn't go below some value. This is like a poor man's version of ambient lighting for the terrain. Finally, the diffuse factor is multiplied by the pixel color to get the final result. Okay, so this is a very nice dynamic light, and it's very easy to change the light direction during the execution of the game. Now, let's take a look at the second method, which I promised is very cool. I was not aware of this technique until I read about it in the book, and despite the obvious deficiencies, I decided to implement it myself, and I was even able to improve the algorithm, so let me tell you about it. This technique is called slope lighting, and it was originally described in a 2001 article by Charlie Van Noland on gamedev.net. The basic idea is to compare the height of the vertex to the one on the way towards the light source. In general, each vertex is located in a center of a 3x3 grid, so it is surrounded by 8 vertices. Let's ignore the height of the light source and simply assume that the light direction goes from left to right. In this case, we subtract the height of the vertex in the center from the one directly on the left, because this vertex can potentially shadow the middle vertex. If the result is positive, it means that the center vertex is indeed in shadow. Otherwise, it is higher than the one on the left, and therefore it receives light and is not shadowed. This, in a nutshell, is the core technique. We have 8 vertices around, so we only have 8 possible directions for the light ray in steps of 45 degrees from one another. We just need to find the vertex which is before the current one on the way to the light source and compare their heights. As I was studying this technique, I started thinking that we shouldn't really be limited to only 8 light directions. We can actually find the two neighboring vertices that the light ray goes between and interpolate the height between them. After all, aren't we the kings and queens of interpolation? Okay, so the first step is to identify the two vertices. To do that, I define two vectors, dir x, which points to the right, and dir z, which points along the positive z-axis. We have to do a dot product of the reversed light direction with the two vectors and check the result against the following table. Here we have the two dot products at the 8 vertices around the center. As you can see, due to the repeating nature of the cosine function, we have to use two vectors which are perpendicular to each other. For example, in the case of Dear X with the top and bottom center vertices, the result is 0 because this is 90 degrees, so we can use Dear Z to distinguish between the two cases, and vice versa with the left and right. Dot product with Dear Z is 0, so we use Dear X. We now need to do a series of checks on the dot product result. If the dot product with Dear Z, aka DPZ, is greater than the cosine of 45 degrees, we know that the light ray is coming from the top three vertices. In that case, delta Z is 1 for the two target vertices, because we have to make one step on the positive Z axis to get to these vertices. If DPZ is smaller than the cosine of 45 degrees, we know that the light ray is coming from the bottom three vertices, and therefore delta Z is minus 1. If it's not one of these cases, we check whether DPZ is greater than or equal to 0. If it is, it means that the light ray goes either between the left and top left vertices, or the right and top right vertices. Either way, it means that the delta Z for the first vertex is 0, and for the second vertex it is 1. If DPZ is less than 0, we have a similar case on the bottom, so delta Z is still 0 for the first vertex, but it is minus 1 for the second. A similar check on DPX will tell us whether we need to go right or left. If both delta Z are 1 or minus 1, we also check DPX to decide whether the two vertices are the center and the left, or the center and the right. So now we have delta X and delta Z to get to the two vertices that the light ray goes between. We also need an interpolation factor to tell us how close the light ray is to the two vertices. This is actually either DPX or DPZ, depending on the cases that we just went through, so the decision is made as we do these checks. Since the relevant values of DPX and DPZ are always between 1 and the cosine of 45 degrees, we need to map them to a range of 0 to 1, which is very simple to do. I've implemented the entire logic of this algorithm in a class called SlopeLIDAR. The function initLIDAR initializes delta X and delta Z for the two vertices, as well as the interpolation factor. This function pretty much follows the logic that we went through, so it should be easy for you to review the code offline. The function getLighting takes a vertex coordinate in the grid and returns the slope lighting factor for it. We use the deltas to find the two target vertices around the light ray. As you can see, I'm actually extending the 3x3 square by multiplying the deltas by some value. This is simply because the results I got with a delta of 1 were not noticeable enough. If you ever use this technique, you may want to tune this yourself. Next, we check whether the two vertices are inside the height map. We extract their heights and use the factor to interpolate between them. The interpolated height is subtracted from the height of the current vertex. This is done this way so that positive values will translate to lit vertices, and negative values will translate to shadow. Notice that the result of the subtraction is divided by something which is called light softness. Lower softness values causes the shadows to appear sharper and in smaller patches, and higher values make the shadow softer and in larger patches. Just another parameter that you may want to tweak. Finally, we do some clamping to make sure the light factor doesn't go above 1. We also have the same poor man's ambient lighting that we saw in the previous technique. No point in doing this in the vertex shader if we can bake this directly into the vertex. And this is where we need to discuss the main deficiency of this technique. Instead of the normal vector, we now have a light factor directly in the vertex buffer. This means that we can no longer do dynamic lighting in the shaders as in the previous technique. Every change in the light direction requires an update of the vertex buffer, but when you think about it, in an actual game you don't really need to change the light direction every frame, so you may be able to find the opportunity to do this without causing a frame rate drop. On the positive side, in this technique we just need to pass through the light factor to the fragment shader, where it is multiplied by the texture color. so there is less work to be done than with diffuse lighting. One way to mitigate this overhead is to switch from an array of structures, which is what we do here. We have a single structure for each vertex, to a structure of arrays, where every attribute goes into a separate vertex buffer. This is actually the technique that I'm using in the OpenGL for Beginners series, and you can find more details in the video on SIMP. In this case, we can just update the light factor vertex buffer without touching the other buffers of position, texture coordinates, etc. With just a single float per vertex, this may be okay. Another deficiency of this technique is the fact that the height of the light source, or the y-coordinate of the light vector, doesn't come into play. The algorithm is done entirely in 2D. However, you can be creative and incorporate this somehow into the calculation. Something to think about. Okay, and there you have it. Two different techniques to light a terrain, each one with its own special characteristics. So let me know what you think in the comments below. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next episode of Terrain Rendering.